Round two.
Let's try this shit again.
Fight.
You were much more fun when you were going to blow yourself up, love.
This sucks.
What's the movie?
What's the movie?
Or what are we doing here? What's the name of this?
Yeah, I'm Dylan.
Shit show.
I'm Dylan.
I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
This is a real sick podcast, so buckle up. We're going to Rubber Dinghy Rapids this week. Pack up all the bleach and peroxide. Let's make some bombs.
What kind of bombs?
The ones that blow yourself up.
And that's a great segue into what this movie is, Four Lions.
Is that what we're talking about?
Yes.
Awesome.
Jim, what was your favorite movie from this line? Our favorite line.
Movie? From what
God
line?
Damn it. What was your favorite line from this movie?
Oh, I don't know. There were a couple that stood out, if I can remember.
So let's just break the fucking tension here, okay? We recorded a great 20 minutes, so this hasn't happened in many episodes, right? I don't even know if we bring it up in the final edit, but this has happened. This is about the third or fourth time.
This is only the second time.
It's the third or fourth time we've lost a piece of a podcast.
Florida Project, Voices in Raw.
Well, Florida Project was a whole different thing.
It was a different debacle. Third time. But this just shows that we're not perfect, guys.
Yeah, it wasn't our fault. Our fourth co-host, Murray, accidentally
pulled the power plug.
Yep,
he pulled the plug on this shit.
He was
luckily
like,
it only
do it again.
Well, maybe we were getting too close to something, right? Maybe he was working for MI5, bro. Okay, maybe we were getting to the bottom of something.
Extra partner suggested that instead of four lions, he wanted to do four pit bulls.
That's right. He's making up for pit bulls everywhere.
Yeah. Fuck pit bulls.
So we lost about 20 minutes and they were solid. So, you know,
it's always hard to like get back in the groove if you have to start over.
It is. Because we made some good jokes.
Especially it's if it's an unscripted.
It's all off the cuff. And then now all of a sudden we're trying to,
redo the jokes.
Yeah, redo the jokes.
Well, we don't need to redo the jokes, all right?
But there was magic.
There's always magic.
Oh, yeah. The ones that like get disappeared forever. Man, you guys are missing literally. You think this is not that good? All the rest that the dogs mess up though, that's the real goal.
Well, I just love the nostalgic lenses we get immediately because they're probably trash, honestly.
Right, exactly.
Every bit of something we missed was probably just trash, but we wanted to think that it was great and because we lost it. But you know what?
We move on
just like these four lions banded together.
They only moved on for a specific amount of time
until to get the job done.
Which they did poorly at as well.
So I'm just going to come up with a quick synopsis of what this movie is.
You're going to come up with it or you're going to read it off IMDb?
Off the cuff.
We're really
four incompetent British terrorists set out to train for and commit an act of terror.
That is what they do.
That's our movie.
That is the movie. So, and thank you for listening this week's Four Lions.
There we go.
Bye. Imagine what the 20 minutes we did would have been. Put that with this 5 minutes. You got yourself a podcast.
300 seconds.
Yeah, well, that's where we get into the really, in-depth discussion, right? So we skipped past that already. Now we're just getting into fart jokes and dick jokes.
I've never heard it said like that. Usually it's dick and fart jokes, not fart and dick jokes.
Well, sometimes you got to fart first.
So I'm going to ask a question that Jim asked last time. Why'd you pick this movie, Dylan?
I picked this movie because, the last couple movies were a little bit of a bummer, right?
Encino Man was a bummer?
That was like four ago.
Okay, what were the last?
We had Trees Lounge.
Yeah.
And the one before that.
Sunshine.
Sunshine was awesome.
Great movie, actually. But not funny.
No.
We
don't do a lot of comedy.
And this is
Deadstream wasn't funny. That sure wasn't
funny. Deadstream was hilarious. Deadstream was awesome.
I thought Vesper was supposed to be a comedy.
That's not true.
Oh. That's not true at all. Okay. It wasn't meant to be a comedy.
Exactly.
It was a comedy.
No, listening to people that don't get it, try to talk about it. Yeah. That's the real humor, right? That's what's funny to me.
So why'd you pick this movie, Dylan?
Because, it's fucking awesome. It's super funny. It's darkly twisted and humorous. And it really touches on a subject that like nobody else jokes about.
It's very macabre.
Very macabre. You don't see a lot of comedy about something
about
so
Middle Eastern terrorists.
About Middle East specifically, yeah. But yeah, I tried watching this movie one time on the recommendation of a friend, and it was at a time where I don't think I was ready to, you know, understand it or get it. And I got about 30 minutes in and just gave up because it just seemed dumb.
It was too much for you?
Yeah.
You weren't ready?
It wasn't hitting me.
It's too highbrow.
Right. Well, I don't know. I think I completely missed any sense of like, I thought that it was just dumb jokes done by people that were, I don't know. It just felt off-putting and strange and not a good way. And then I gave it a chance a few years later and really identified with, you know, the humor in
about
it.
About being a terrorist?
Well, just the approach to it, man, because something so fucked up and...
It's a very fucked up movie.
Very fucked up, but taken sort of lightheartedly.
And, very lightheartedly.
You know?
Yes. Huh? I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And yeah, I don't know, man. I really had a good time with this movie and I thought that it'd be great on a rewatch. So I was happy to get back into it and I wanted to see what you guys think about it.
I thought it was interesting. I thought it was funny. It's an odd setup for a movie like this. Again, being a super dark movie or premise, but then throwing in like the Office characters in it. And it's filmed like The Office. It's like partially found footage. It just creates like a off tone where you're like, the things that are going on in this movie are fucked up, but everybody's so happy-go-lucky.
They're just living their lives.
Except
man.
For Omar. He's like the gym. Do you watch The Office?
I'm familiar with it.
Omar's like the gym of Four Lions.
Yeah, also, I mean, they don't do like the interview style.
No.
But
I think that would have helped the movie.
Oh yeah, I think it'd have been hilarious. Yeah, they definitely, there's the found footage, there's like CTC cameras, there's
CCTV,
yeah. The cop videos, you know, are they being surveilled? So, yeah.
Nice little cameo by, what was his
Benedict.
Name?
Benedict Cumberbatch.
Yeah, I got him on there.
Where the fuck did he come from?
Was it even a cameo back then? Or was that just like one of his first acting
kids? Oh, I think he was pretty established.
Was he doing Doctor Who at that point?
He does little.
Was he Doctor Who?
I don't know.
I feel like
he was Doctor Who at some point.
He was Sherlock at that point. Yeah.
Sherlock, that's
yeah,
right.
Yeah, that was like the contemporary at the time. No, he was an accomplished actor. For I think a while in the UK,
he does do. I've seen him in more than one, just out of nowhere, usually toward the end of the movie or something. He played Jesus in this weird like black Jesus movie that came out last year.
Did he play the white Jesus in the black Jesus movie?
The Book of Clarence.
Yeah, I heard good things about that. It's got Lakeith Stanfield in it.
It was
as well.
It was one of those. It was a good concept, and they kind of just you could tell there's a lot of great production value, but. If you want to watch that, maybe we can do that one.
Yeah, we'll do that
anyway.
So what was your experience with this movie then, Jim?
So I'd never seen it and I watched it for the first time last night. I watched it with my lady. She was a little high, cracked up through the whole thing.
You know? A little high?
Did she give you a review? Did you bring in any?
You know, we left it, you know, leave it for the podcast. That's how we do.
Yeah.
I told her what I would probably be giving it. It was definitely right off the bat, I really liked it. And again, when you talk about like, you know, these bumbling, you know, the other thing, I don't know if you, you know, these guys are, it's just a clown car show. I mean, it's just, three stooges. They don't know what they're doing. You got a couple of guys who are obviously have mental problems. You have
at least one for sure. He's got a learning disability.
Yeah, a little bit.
Not a lot of bit, man.
But he's really sweet.
He wants to blow up, you know, other people.
He's just doing what his friends are doing. All right. He doesn't,
Those are the most dangerous people.
Sure. Sure. Because this movie, what it's really about, right, is friendship.
It's friendship.
That's what this movie's really about.
That is true.
It's not. It's about the friends you made along the way.
Or that you already had while you're going down
whatever,
the road.
Whatever. On the way to making nitroglycerin. Blowing up sheep.
With fucking bleach and what else?
Peroxide?
Peroxide.
Which
I guess is...
Sounds good enough?
Yeah, I don't know. I believed it.
Look good.
But I think it's worth kind of going a little bit through the movie. Because
Yeah, because this movie just hits the ground running.
Yeah. I mean, you're immediately introduced to these four guys who are committed to the jihad cause.
Yes.
At least surfacely.
Well, they believe they are the Mujahideen, which are the freedom fighters, right? Yeah. And they don't really... Immediately, you can tell that they're training to do something, right? They're
training?
Making, well, for sure. Well, they're prepared. They're preparing to do some kind of act, right? And they all are ill-prepared.
Dylan, right? Why don't you introduce the characters?
So we got Omar, which is played by a young Riz Ahmed, who at this point already had a fairly successful career in the UK, been in a bunch of films, but who recently is in a bunch of highly... He was in Nightcrawler.
He was in Nightcrawler.
He was in Nightcrawler, right, Rogue One, him. Sound of Metal.
About Nightcrawler. He was awesome in Nightcrawler.
Yeah. Yeah. No, fantastic actor.
Are you
going
to get paid for this?
I mean, fantastic actor. Then
like
you got
Nightcrawler.
Nightcrawler is 2014.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, about four years ago. After this one. Then you got Adil Akhtar, who plays Faisal.
Is he the mentally challenged cousin?
No, he is the one that blows himself up with the sheep.
He's the mentally challenged retard.
No.
He has problems.
You're thinking of Waj. You're thinking about his dad. His dad, who they allude to several times, eats toilet paper and has gone on to eating moths.
But that guy the reason
he can't
too.
Go. Sure. Mm. Seems like they don't have the best lives going. They don't got the most success going on in their lives. So you got
I don't Riz know about Ahmed. That because
Omar seems to be the only one that's really put together.
Well, he has a wife
and
a kid and a nice house.
And they're supportive.
Yeah. Like supportive of murdering and killing himself.
Yeah.
Like super supportive.
Yeah, oddly supportive.
Like there's nothing that is not shared in this family.
Yeah. Nothing. No. And there, I mean, I wish I had that kind of support at home, Chris.
Agreed.
Yeah. When are you going to join the jihad with me, brother?
Never. When you find a cause that's worth dying for.
Yeah. I don't believe in anything.
Like even yourself.
Barely.
Barely.
Then we also got.
I believe in you, Dylan.
Thank you. We also have Nandor the Relentless played by, Nandor the Relentless is Kayvon Novak playing our learning disabled friend Waj.
Yeah.
No, yep. That was a cousin.
Well, either way.
I don't know the relationship.
Yeah, I don't know.
He's
the
cousin of Omar.
Yeah, that checks out. Good enough. And then you got Barry, who is the most serious about
and less serious at the same time.
Well, the most serious but the least knowledgeable and equipped. He's just that guy
just
is
angry.
The convert.
He's white.
Yeah,
he's a white Briton, and he's just one of these guys who gloms onto something because he has nothing else. And he's like, because he's the white guy, he's
the most extreme.
You know what it reminds me of? You remember that Patty Hearst movie or in that whole scenario?
Yeah.
Ms. Moon?
I know who you're talking about.
But that, what was the gang called?
The Symbian Lebanese
Army. Are you not listening to the
I am.
Last podcast?
I am.
Okay, yeah.
But
the SLA, man.
Yeah, SLA. It definitely reminds me of like the SLA and how they're described in that.
Very
like,
similar,
you know, like,
we
need black leadership.
Is that what you're referring to? Yeah. Because that is the funniest thing. That's a black revolutionary group with one black guy in
it. Yeah, it's Ving Rhames.
Who was overcast in that? Because
I like that movie.
Yeah. No, for
but
sure.
As for the real life interpretation, I mean, Ving Rhames' interpretation of the real life character.
Yeah, the real life guy sucked ass.
Yeah, like way worse, and was not as buff or cool.
Not buff, not cool, not knowledgeable.
Just was there to screw white chicks.
Yeah.
No, I mean, he believed.
He believed. He, yeah. Either way, we're getting off topic. But I see the similarities there between the SLA. It's funny that maybe that could have sprung something in me. I don't know. I don't know exactly how these movies come to me when I pick them. All right. But we got done, you know, talking about Trees Lounge last week. By the
way, that one is not a comedy.
No.
It seems like it is.
Take your clothes off, Patty.
Well, the story is a bunch of bumbling idiots, but just in a bunch of real life story is just a lot darker.
It's because it's a true story. This would be a lot darker if it was true.
If this was true, it'd be a lot darker.
I mean, I've heard like the 9/11 stories of like the guys that drove into the planes and they weren't the sharpest tools in the sheds to begin with.
Our next movie you should pick is Loose Change, man.
Or Zeitgeist.
Yeah.
Did you ever see Zeitgeist?
Yeah. A little, oh, okay.
Yeah, I was 13.
Yeah, I was 13.
I was 13 and thought
Chris
shit was
like
deep.
18.
Yeah. Making everybody watch that shit.
Yeah, I thought I was going to make a change.
Like, come on, Chris.
What?
I was like, by the time they got to Zeitgeist 3, it was like,
there's a third one?
Yeah, there's three of them.
Have you seen, hasn't this fallen apart in your mind yet?
Nope. No, I was a believer.
Fact. Still moving to France.
was that a thing I said?
No. You have done really weird shit. I could tell a really funny story about Chris.
Do it.
If you want to be way off topic.
Yeah, let's go.
The 2012 Mayan calendar. Yeah. So Chris was like, hey, man, you know, I got this. It's a broken down Jeep, but I think if I make it down to Peru, you're broken down green truck, right?
Yeah.
He's like, I just want to be there for it because I think maybe if I go up to Machu Picchu, I'll get like superpowers or something. And I'm looking at him like, dude, man,
you're right.
You're fucking serious. And I'm just like, hell yeah, do it, bro. He ain't getting past the border.
No. Man, like, I wish I would have got a bigger size in my shirt. I bought a Mayan calendar t-shirt when I was down in Belize.
How old was I in 2012?
God,
22.
Out. Yeah.
I was like, superpowers are coming.
Yes.
It's going to be like Heroes.
Yeah, that's what you said.
I think I was watching Heroes at that time.
Christ, man, the way how easy it is to manipulate young people is pretty scary.
I'm still as manipulable.
Yeah, I guess you are.
Just a fucking
after the Y2K thing, everything went out the window for me. It's just like, I don't believe anything anymore. Fuck this shit. It's all lies.
You got to keep the hope alive for some magic in this universe.
The curtain was pulled in Y2K for Jim.
I'm not embarrassed at all.
I still believe.
I'm not embarrassed. I'm embarrassed for you.
I don't know what I believe.
Okay, I'm sorry.
It's definitely not in yourself.
Yeah, because I don't believe in anything.
Into the movie, about 18 minutes into our podcast.
Yeah.
They're just gathering all their stupid shit, trying to get bomb making materials.
Two of them get sent
to the training camp.
No, they don't get sent. They just, the one guy, the most serious guy.
Omar.
Omar is the most serious. Barry is kind of comic relief. Barry's the white guy.
Overly angry.
Right. He's just pissed at everything. And
so angry.
And Omar has some contact in Pakistan where apparently, again, I didn't really look it up or anything, but I don't really know. Obviously, the filmmakers know all this. Like Dylan was saying before, this director, writer had researched this movie for like 3 years.
Right.
He talked to religious leaders, what makes people radicalize into fundamentalist religions, how people actually believe they're going to in this, you know. Because obviously there are a couple of these guys who have great lives. There's no reason they would be mad at England for anything. One guy's rich. The other guy has a beautiful wife and son, apparently good job, nice place. And then the other guys are a little more, you know, just persuadable, Chris level. And
fuck off. One thing I won't do is join a weird cause. Okay. I've never been a cause guy.
Never been a doomsday prepper?
Nah.
You just haven't found the right cause, Chris. Yeah.
Nope.
I'll find it for you.
Nope. If I made my own cause, maybe.
There we go.
There you go.
Start a cult.
That's what we talked about a lot, Jim.
You got to be a lot more sure of yourself to start a cult, though. You don't got to believe it, but you got to at least.
No. That's the thing.
You got to at least those show guys, the people that you believe.
I think that the people, they might start it out of not believing, but then they end up believing their own.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I mean, and.
Otherwise, you're just a televangelist scammer. You're not really.
Well.
I have the shirt that says future cult leader.
So that's it?
That's it. That's all you need.
Yeah.
That's all you need.
How many are in the cult of Chris yet?
You two, you joined this podcast.
Is that what we're fucking doing here?
Yeah.
No, it is a cult of two, and I think it's Murray and Josie because you feed them.
Yep.
Is that why you bought all this peroxide and Kool-Aid?
Peroxide and Kool-Aid?
Yeah.
You're sending us off to do your suicide bombs for you?
Flavored. Fruit punch.
So anyway, the Omar guy has like an uncle in Pakistan. And again, I didn't really know much about, like, I guess that's where in Britain, that's where all of their homegrown terrorism comes from because they have a very large Pakistani.
Well, that's where Al Qaeda had most of their training.
Right. But it's also, I think, because England must have a lot of their immigrants, a lot of their Pakistani immigrants. A lot of immigrants are coming from Pakistan.
Sure. And I think it's just easier to get into
from Pakistan.
Because, I mean, you're not getting a one-way ticket to Afghanistan or Iraq in that time without some flags being raised. But Pakistan is a place that there's still travel between.
Everybody kind of wants to go. And
to the training camp?
Yeah.
No, only.
No, everybody, well, everybody wants to go.
No, the Fizzle doesn't want to go.
Yeah.
Well, no, he can't. Because his dad.
Yeah, but he don't want to go either.
And then the Barry guy really wants to go to the point where he's like, it was pretty funny on the way to the airport. He's like swallowing keys and just doing all this stupid shit.
Yeah. And they frogged him.
They frogged him.
We weren't doing the frogging.
I didn't even know it.
We wouldn't do any frogging.
But yeah, and he says, you know, how's your Urdu? I think that's the language.
Yeah.
And obviously, if you can't speak the language.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're a big fucking target.
So anyway, they go to Pakistan and it's just his cousin, Waj, who has some mental problems. Okay. And Omar.
Intellectual disabilities.
He's got a learning disability.
Yeah. Okay.
He gets confused. Not all there.
It's established. It's hard for him to read. He literally reads like a 3-4-year-old picture book about being a martyr.
going through his shit is so fucking funny because they pull out that book and then he's also got the prayer bear.
Does all the
prayers for him.
When they get to Pakistan, they're going through his luggage and they're like, oh, no, it's not them. It's the terrorists.
It's the uncle,
it's the terrorists. They're like, what the hell? What is this? It's my prayer bear. So he's that low. He's maybe like the level of like a 6-7-year-old. Intellectually, I would say.
Yeah.
Anyway, so Chris, what? they're at the camp,
and
they fucking
and there's American drones that are coming in, and these guys are
the cousin is just doing like he's shooting an AK-47 and like uploading it or something.
Well, the funny line where he was like, where you can kind of see like, because Omar is portrayed as like the smarter one, initially, but. When you kind of get his like, oh, he's not all there either. Like he's faking it to make it is when the drone shows up when they first get to Pakistan, he's like, I'll take it out.
Yeah.
And then they're like, no, it's too high. He's like, yeah, I thought so. It's about 2,000 feet. About 2,000 feet up.
Well, he's got the heart. He's just not fully there. And
he's not knowledgeable.
He's not very knowledgeable. And it doesn't really, what I think is interesting too, though, because it doesn't completely get into like motivations.
No.
And why?
I mean, kind
of. I mean, a little bit. Yeah, I mean, here's some of the surface level. In his he has a couple monologues where he's talking about, you know, the Western imperialists.
Yeah, but look at how they live. They live in a Western imperialist, just like in reality, the 9/11 guys were going to strip clubs doing cocaine.
You know?
I mean, it's like all the top people who are funding all that stuff are the Saudi princes who live like the worst emperors of Rome, in real life.
Well, and the money all comes from capitalist nations, right? So all the
buying
funding,
the oil,
all the funding for these organizations. I mean,
it's coming from everywhere.
It's coming from everywhere, but it comes from a lot of these places that they are. So I think really the hypocrisy in the beliefs, right, is something that is kind of just joked about.
What is the line that Barry says? Or is like, does your dad buy
Jaffa oranges, and Jaffa is a city in Israel.
Right. Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, well, I'm once or twice. He's like, he's a Jew.
Your dad's a Jew. Yeah.
He had a lot of funny lines. There was the one where he goes, Islam's going to shit. Women are talking back. People are playing stringed instruments.
It's the apocalypse.
We're at the end of days.
Yeah. I was very curious about what's the deal with stringed instruments.
It's some crazy. Again, it's like, go through the Bible and you're going to find the craziest shit ever.
Absolutely.
You can't eat lobster, shellfish. You can't be around a woman at certain times. I don't really know all the intricacies of Islam, but I assume they're fundamentalist people who read a book 1500 years old or 1400 years old, whatever, you know, and you take that word for word.
Yeah.
Is, you know, and I love how the fundamentalist Christians think those people are nuts when they do the exact,
they do the same shit.
They wish people were more fanatical and believed it or wherever.
Well, the weird thing about fundamentalist Christians and even like Christianity in general is they're interpreting an interpreted book.
Right.
Like the original Bible isn't written in Old English.
No.
So, I mean, even the...
Yeah, it got translated years later.
Yeah, even following like that off translation is just ridiculous, in my opinion.
You could do that with any. You could do that with Alice in Wonderland and just start a religion around that.
It's true. Mm-hmm. What book would you start a religion with, Dylan?
Dylan would do The Road.
He would probably do 1984.
No, it's definitely Harry Potter. I mean, that was the most...
Just make up that people can be wizards. Why not?
That was the first time. So reading Harry Potter. So it came out. I was in first grade. And I
are we going into Harry Potter?
I already didn't feel like I belonged in this world.
Oh, of course.
Right. And Harry Potter and those books in general were the first place that I was able to finally escape me and be who I knew I wanted to be. Right. Which is the most important kid at the magic school of magic kids. Right. And I think that that's something that like
you identified with.
Well, I have taken it throughout other areas of my life. You know, that's why I think I fell into the love and film and storytelling. You
were the one who lives.
I was the one who lives. Yeah.
This is makes me the most understanding why you identify with a Vesper.
It all makes sense.
I think my favorite part of the movie was when they were in Pakistan.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it definitely was snappy.
And then them coming back.
Well, there's one important thing for the end credits, too. It's kind of funny. So as the cousin is shooting off his AK-47, the leader of the terrorist camp is like, you know, you're fucking nuts, you know, and you're going to bring in, you know.
We're going to get us noticed.
Yeah. And so you can't come to, I don't know why they need, they're trying to get to meet some religious guy who would give them the blessing to do jihad.
And maybe emir.
Emir, and maybe some tactical support, who knows. But
I think they need the blessing. If you're going to start, you're going to start any kind of cell.
And so this guy is like, you guys are total fuck ups. You're out of here tomorrow. You're staying behind.
They immediately get spun.
And so that guy and the rest of the terrorists go off to meet the emir, who knows who it is. And they're just dicking around as morons do. And I think it's Omar. He grabs a bazooka. And this was obvious. You could tell.
It had an arrow pointing.
behind him. And so he accidentally shoots it behind him and it goes and like blows up the caravan of his own people. And they're like, okay, time to go home.
They immediately come back.
That will come back later. So they go home.
Yeah. They go home and now we're introduced to the rapper character.
Oh my God.
Oh, while they were gone, the Barry guy.
Yeah. One of my favorite scenes is Barry's on this panel, right? This panel where, you know, they're trying to talk about Islamic issues because this is 2010. So think about the culture in America in 2010. I mean, we're nine years post 9/11, right? I mean, I grew up. I mean, most of my formative years and school years were spent in the post 9/11 era, right? Where, I mean, the word terrorist was just right here in the forefront.
Terrorists.
Yeah, the war on terror, terrorists, the Middle East. I mean, I had such a distorted view of an entire culture, an entire, I mean, a fucking quarter of the world, right, are of Muslim more descent, right? More, maybe more, but
almost half.
Yeah, I mean, a shitload of people on this planet, right, in a giant part of the world are of this thing that I just have no fucking clue and I don't understand, right? And I feel like I was a fairly progressive kid. I grew up on The Daily Show and with lefty talking points and I felt fairly accepting of others, but I had no fucking clue what was really going on and what these people were about or what they believed in. And I think I fell right into the same thing that a lot of Americans, and it seems like British people as well, were this was is the otherness of,
well,
you know.
You know, one note about this too, when America's in something,
the world's in it.
Right. And Western, so Britain world. Is in it. And, yeah.
And Canada.
It's the only time, of course, Canada. No, it's NATO. It's the only time in NATO's history, their Article 4 of NATO says, if any country is attacked, everybody else in the treaty has to come and defend that country. It's never been revoked ever except for after 9/11. So all of Western Europe and Canada were bound by treaty to come. That was one of the big problems, because like these countries are just sending in, you know, great. And what, here are the Spanish and the Italians and the French and the Norway guys and the British guys, and everybody has their own, you know, and it's like literally like 1,000 guys here. I thought, you know, they're not really doing anything. You see that movie with Brad Pitt, War?
You mean Babel?
No. He's the general. It's a true story. Oh, I can't believe
the man who stared at goats.
No. It's Brad Pitt. It's a Netflix movie. Where he's playing a real life general, and there's just.
And they're pulling out of nine, or
not pulling out, but he's sent in fix it, to fix it, war something, war machine.
There you go.
Is that it? Okay. And it's just like, there's all these, he's got to deal with 30 leaders of their armed forces in all these different offices. And it's just a shit show, you know, 'cause there's no one, you know, one way to do it. And so anyway, Dylan, to your point, at that time, everybody was in it, even though it only seemed like it seems like it's all America because we're 90% of the people there.
Oh, for sure. But, and this is just our experience. And right. Like, I mean, just growing up and learning more about the world. And,
but so,
and see that more, yeah.
So Barry, the crazy fanatic, is on this like liberal college panel of like how in Britain we need to accept. No, all the Muslims are not like this. They don't want to join the jihad. Right? No, not at all.
They just want to live their lives.
Right. Thank you. Take away this thing.
And then he is exactly what they're trying to like tell people that they're not. I mean, he comes in as this jihadist really ill-informed as well. He's just all gusto.
He's ridiculous.
Yeah. He's a fucking caricature.
It's funny. It's really funny.
It's hilarious.
I love seeing his beard and his accent. Yeah. His like weirdly
gruff, like working class British accent.
Yeah. But then like during the panel, Hassan stands up and does this whole monologue about like everybody thinks I'm a bomber, then I should be a bomber.
Might
as well be a bomber. And then he takes off his jacket and he's got bombs.
He starts doing like
He starts rapping. Rap. And I love that, like in every one of his raps, he references Tupac.
Yeah. He does. And then he pulls them and it's confetti. Just confetti. And the funniest thing is, he's like, you guys just believed it because I'm Muslim. Yeah.
He's getting dragged.
You just believed it was real because I'm Muslim.
Barry's like, I can't believe you're dragging away.
You know how much actual jail time you would get if you pulled that shit?
Oh,
especially
done,
back
dude.
In the day.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. The
even
war on
now,
terror was still.
You'd get 5 years or something.
I mean, just putting this podcast out, I'm sure we're on
people,
somebody's
dude.
List.
You swap people now, they got fucking big time laws for that shit.
Yeah. Heck, you can't pull a prank like that.
No. Go fake bomb a college
classroom. You probably made
classroom.
Some of those pussies fucking piss their pants. Oh. You know? I would have pissed my pants. Yeah.
Yeah. I've been like, God damn it, this is how I go out.
Get this crazy man rapping about jihad.
He just referenced Tupac. I'm going to die now.
Dude, the second the guy stood, well, first of all, I'd never be in that audience, but the second that guy stood up, I got to go. Yeah. You know, it's
like, he mentioned bombs, we're out of here. Yeah.
So then Barry sees this guy's, sees his,
potential,
potential.
Pulls and recruits him in the most ridiculous way.
See, what you're doing ain't real.
Yeah.
He drives very slowly into a wall.
That was real.
That was real.
Everything the guy says in response is like, how many times do you go to mosque? And he's like, oh, I try to go as much as possible. Friday prayers. And he's like, I haven't been to mosque.
He said one time a year is too many.
Yeah, one time a year is too many.
The mosques have
been infiltrated.
Well, and it kind of, so they allude to, so you can see the research that was done by this guy, because there is a distinct difference between what like the jihadists believe and what mainstream Islam believes, right? I mean, just his talking point.
Tell me about that, subtle. Dylan. What are the differences?
Well, so it's subtle there, right? I don't know the specific differences, but they don't agree with what the church is doing as a whole. I mean, these guys break off. Well, they're sure. Breaking off.
They're extremists.
Yeah. Exactly. So, I mean, just his talking point of, because a lot of the sensationalism that I grew up with, right, that I remember, you know, being spout, all the rhetoric I remember being spout out, was so ill-informed and just completely fucking ignorant. I mean, all the people out here that I remember talking about Muslims and Islam had no fucking clue what any of it was and what any of it meant and what the difference is between the mainstream, which is 99.9% of Muslims are not fucking making bombs
they're not extremist
in their basement.
Terrorists.
Exactly. But what I grew up with and what I remember seeing is a bunch of people who were ill-informed, had no clue what they're talking about, just grouping it all together.
Well, I mean, there's also like sprinkled in with U.S. propaganda.
Oh, and, for sure.
You know,
if anything, I think, you know, at the time, you know, George W. Bush was the devil.
I have one question for you, Dylan, about that's semi-related.
Sure.
Did you think 9/11 was an inside job?
No. I did not.
Well, jumping ahead a little. No, on that point. So we eventually meet the brother of Omar, who's also must be the cousin of Waj. And this guy is coming and he's fully as nuts fundamentalist. And he's coming there saying, this is not the way. Islam, he knows what he's going to be doing. This is not, Islam is peace and we don't do this at all.
Oh, his brother.
And Omar's brother, if anything, is way worse than him.
Like, yeah, studying.
Yeah, he literally won't. He literally won't step in the room because his wife is there. He literally won't. His wife, he locks in a bathroom,
in a cupboard,
because when he's not there, she needs to be confined in her own special room. And that's a real thing with these nuts.
Well, so I think that just that specific.
And he's supposed to be the good one.
Yeah,
well, I don't know if they're. He's not the one that is going to be committing violence and murdering innocent people, right?
So but this he's still
a fundamentalist.
He's a fundamentalist.
He's going to just, you know, he's, in my opinion, the kid of that guy's nephew is going to grow up a lot saner than any kids that this guy has, where he's going to raise them to maybe not be jihadists, but they're going to be just the most misogynist, nut, evil.
Yeah, don't. You're talking about just like human respect.
Yeah. And that's kind of the fanatic. You know, it's not even fundamentalism. It's straight up fanatical. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think that we could be stepping on a whole bucket of worms if we get into like, because I don't have any specific beliefs.
No,
really,
I'm trying to look at the writer's motivation.
Yeah.
Like, because there's absolutely no redeemable characters in this movie.
I think the wife's pretty all right.
Dude, she wants her husband to go murder as many people as possible.
Yeah, she's for it. She's happily for it.
Yeah, she's high-fiving her.
They believe in it.
What?
Yeah. They believe in it.
Well, again, so they believe in evil.
Yeah.
Just does it in a really, really nice way.
In our opinion.
Well, I mean, I think that's what I was going to touch on.
Do you not think that that's bad?
I don't think murdering innocent people is okay. No.
In any situation.
No. That's it's never well, justified.
Then they must not be good people.
I mean, they don't believe that, but I think that that's the interesting concept, though, because it's not whether I think it's right or not. I mean, what they do and what their life means to them.
Dylan is talking about religious freedoms.
Well, just human freedoms. I'm not saying they have the freedom to go murder people, but to think that, you know, they're inherently evil or bad people, I think is reductive and missing out.
Do you think that Ted Bundy was an evil person?
I think that murder is not okay, right? And it's against, I mean, the natural order of things.
No, it's one of the most natural things humans have done throughout history. So it's absolutely not against the natural order. Everything kills other things. Every day you
yeah, for a reason.
Every day you step on bugs.
Uh-huh.
You're killing bacteria right now.
Yeah, I mean, you're a monster.
But you know what makes Dylan not a monster? He's not doing it for God.
Ah. Right.
Oh. I'm just kidding. Can we get back to the movie?
No.
So they come back. We're introduced to Hassan, the rapper.
Hassan's in the group and Omar is not okay with it.
No. And
the other thing too is like, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Omar immediately, well, you're just skipping over stuff. Oh,
go ahead.
Omar is lying to everybody saying, oh yeah, we actually met the guy and he said everything's on and
yeah, we got a backer. We got an emir.
And now he's trying to like take over the whole group. Like I'm the guy who got the thing done. And this is the first time we ever see him get his cousin where he's like, just get, you know, his whole mindset of like lying in order to get what you want, rationalizing. Uh-huh. He does it to his cousin. He does it to his son later. Immediately
about the Lion King.
Yeah. Yeah. Immediately the Barry guy is like, bullocks.
You know? Hey, you're lying.
And then they meet the Hassan guy and
they're a dick to him. Well, he's an idiot too.
He's an idiot. But Omar is now like, hey, I've been to jihad training and now I'm the hard ass, you know, even though he just completely fucked it up.
Yeah. So. Yeah. He blew up a camp. He blew up a camp because he doesn't know what he's doing.
He killed a lot of people.
He killed a bunch of people.
He killed way more of his own people in the movie than he did.
They all did.
Yeah, every one of them. I think there's maybe one guy.
Barry wanted to kill as many Muslims as possible.
He did.
What do they call? They continue to call I think they're calling the Westerners. What's the word that they use?
Kafar. Something with a
kafar,
K.
Yeah. Look it up. I think it's kafar.
A British term. Yeah. I'm not familiar.
But I think so at this point in the movie is when they start deciding like what to blow up.
Yeah.
What their cause is going to be.
Targets are going to be targets. Yeah. Yeah.
And how they're going to break out as these terrorists.
Martyrs. Not yeah. Terrorists.
Martyrs. Sure. And Barry specifically wants to blow up a mosque because he thinks that it will inspire
the normal
Muslims to become extremists.
Right. It's good. Yeah. It's gonna what radicalize the moderates. Yeah,
exactly. And everybody thinks it's ridiculous.
Yeah. Well, because if you're trying to, I mean, if it's all in the name of your religion and your God to blow up your own people, seems a little counterintuitive.
I love Omar's argument where he's like, "I'm gonna fight you." Right, oh, yeah. For a while, and then
punch yourself in the face
and jazz yourself up
so you fight
better.
To motivate you
to fight better and win the fight. And that's what he does. He starts smacking him around, and then he eventually punches himself in the face, and it doesn't work.
That doesn't work.
No.
Yeah, and then he punches Faisal in the
headbutts
face.
Him.
Headbutts him.
Yeah, he broke the beak of the bird,
which is a part of this movie that is. I mean, what is so compelling in it, right? Because it's the slapstick and the goofy and the humor mixed within like the real like consequences of what these like how really serious and like heavy this stuff feels.
Yeah, that's the thing too. It flops
back and forth, you know, regularly.
Yeah, because you're watching it and you're like, I'm laughing, but this is fucking terrible.
This is fucked up.
Yeah, again, like, yeah, yeah. It's like there's.
And not only that,
a fine line, you know.
Well, the weird part is again, we've talked about like sympathizing with characters. And especially this movie, you're just like, okay, well, like they're lovable and they're bumbly and I kind of want them to like, wait, I don't.
Don't succeed.
Like, you're like, I'm rooting for you to kill people. Yeah, right, right. To like blow up a, you know, mosque and or a triathlon, a marathon.
Yeah.
And you have to like catch yourself.
Yeah, you're like, wait, well, no, I don't.
It's one thing when you see like, this could have been the exact same movie, but like bumbling bank robbers. And so you're rooting for them. So you know it's going to go to shit, but yeah, they're not just, you know, these misogynistic fucking assholes teaching their kids to be murderers. And every time, like they, I don't, you know, and again, this is what I kept coming back to over and over and over was like, are they trying to portray all these people as just really, really bad? Because even like the good Muslims are supportive of the jihad. Even the brother who's for peace is a dick to his wife, you know? I'm trying
to figure out how to say this. I just thought it was more real than anything. Because like, I think everybody's kind of a dick for their own reasons.
But yeah, does in that a specific mean that situation. All Muslims then hate the West? Because no. that's exactly what this movie's but, saying.
No, it's not.
Who are the good Muslims?
They're so just the brother. The brother. So I think you've come back to this a couple times already, right? And I think that from the outside, from our perspective, somebody that is treating their life and existing in that way seems so fucking strange that I automatically want to think that this guy's wrong in that, right? But I don't fucking know their culture, right? I don't know what she feels. We don't understand any of their motivations or what their life actually looks like.
But, empowered to judge like Jonestown because why? That guy was bad.
I'm not talking about Jonestown. I'm talking about this specifically.
I'm saying,
right?
Though, is it just because there's so many Muslims? I'm talking about, okay, this movie, you know, who's the good Muslim?
Well, no, I mean, because it's been brought up a couple of times. I mean, that is being the bad Muslim, though. I mean, that's their life and how they exist. You know?
I think the comedy of the movie and why it's good is because, yes, they are paper. When you think about what they're doing, they're bad people. I don't care what culture or religion you're in. Their goal is to kill as many people as they possibly can. But it's a comedy.
Right.
So I don't care which comedy it is, you're going to have, especially this kind of comedy where it's almost like a heist movie where you want them again, cause it's a comedy. You're kind of rooting them for them to complete their goal. That's I think what the genius of the movie is.
Yeah. Again, though, you know, in some it's usually the people they're pulling the heist. You're on their side because the people they're pulling the heist again have done something bad or bad people.
Not in every heist movie.
These are just complete or just a, what's the Bill Murray, Gina Davis one where he's the clown going in. Just a faceless bank, you know?
Again, I think that's the good thing about filmmaking.
Stealing, you know, but it's not about like, I'm rooting for oh God, you know, it'd be so great if, and again, they're not trying to kill as many people as possible. They are, but it's for a reason. It's to get into heaven and get more virgins or whatever they believe, whatever the paradise is they think they're getting martyred into.
Right.
So it's not, you know, they're not just, they're radicalized.
But they're sweethearts.
Yeah, exactly.
That's what I'm trying to say is like, they're sweet. They're like,
but they don't go into any of the background. That's what, you know, I don't know. It just seems a little.
And that's your perspective, Jim. Yeah. And then I accept that. But again,
you do make a good point. Like you say, it is a comedy.
It's a comedy.
You just have to accept it as that.
Yeah. And it's, I mean, he might have done 3 years of research on it, but I mean, how much of that do you actually see?
How much can you portray and tell in an hour and 40 minute movie?
Yeah. And not only in an hour and 40 minutes, but a slapstick comedy, you know, I mean, it seemed accurate. The language seemed correct. Do you really need to go into the intricacies of like their religion and
no, like, and it doesn't really even do that.
Exactly.
You know, so it shows us in light strokes.
Again,
you know,
in storytelling, a sympathetic character goes a long way with the audience because that was the one problem I had through the whole thing. That's all I'm saying.
Was that you didn't sympathize.
There's nobody to sympathize.
I would disagree.
Yeah, I think I sympathize with a lot of them, but in a way that it was like Chris was alluding to earlier.
It's like
right?
sympathizing with Hannibal Lecter.
Well, for sure. It's like
which I've done.
Yeah,
right. It's not like you're proud that you're sympathizing with these people, but I think that's really, like you were saying, the genius, that's really shows you how effective they were, at least in my experience with this film, was how effectively they were able to get you to give a shit about these people, even though you know what their motivation is to do something that is going to hurt a lot of people, or in the very least is extremely wrong and immoral and illegal.
Well,
right.
It's not even that when I say sympathize, it's not that I sympathize with their cause or with what they're doing. I'm able to see their perspective.
Right.
And that's really all I'm watching the movie and I understand their perspective. So I'm in it and I'm in the movie. And are there times where I'm like, oh, that's fucked up? I mean, again, this is what's really awesome about this movie. It's funny. It's kind of sweet.
Yeah.
But it's really dark and fucked up.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a definitely very British movie because you don't see a lot of this style of storytelling.
I think
in the U.S.
Well, I think you see a ton of this style of film or storytelling. It's just not the subject.
Not the subject matter. Yeah. Well, that's what I'm saying. I mean, with like the dark subject matter.
He's
well,
the hero. The hero is a serial killer.
Well, I mean, what we're talking about, the style of storytelling is 80% of network television right now.
Yeah.
I mean, but the subject matter is. Is, again,
what sets it apart?
What sets it apart makes it funny and and provocative and
very provocative. It's so provocative.
So much. This is going back a long time. So much of U.S. culture that I don't think a lot of people realize does come from the U.K.
Yeah. With the original Office.
Exactly. Just
but which you always see a difference. How many U.K. like created series?
Well, the reason
films?
Why the reason why is because you have producers who have absolutely no talent. And so all they do is go look at what's popular everywhere else. Oh, we could do that here and do it better for an American audience. If they could speak French, they'd be pulling all the French stuff over here.
What again? Raw in America?
I mean, well, I think it goes to music, it goes to TV, it goes to movies. There's remake upon remake.
But it's also reversible. So there's, you know, Indian Breaking Bad.
Yeah.
And tons of countries have remade Breaking
Bad.
Well,
India's redone everything out here.
It's true.
The Indian
but I'm just saying it's reversible. So,
but
like,
you're not going to see a British Terminator or a Titanic.
I guarantee there's a British Terminator.
I guarantee there is too. But just in my experience with it, so there's this show Utopia. You ever seen it? There was the U.S. one I saw originally, right? And it came out a few years after the British one. And I go back and watch the British one. And it's a lot less lighthearted and there's not really any redeeming, like there's a lot less redeeming characters and qualities. And we, in America, we want the happy ending or the meaning.
Sympathetic
or the,
character.
Right. Yeah, we want like some kind of.
Somebody to root for.
We want somebody to root for. We want some good to come from it. Right. But I think in England,
even if
like,
it doesn't happen, we want that. And it keeps us,
let's look at the show Shameless.
Yeah.
That was a British show originally. And again, there shouldn't be anybody in that show that is redeemable. Uh-huh. They're all kind of shitty people. Have you seen that show, Jim?
A little.
Have you seen that show?
Just the American. Yeah, I haven't even watched the British one.
The British one, again, exactly the same. They're just that much more different and like less identifiable. Yeah. But again, we're also not British.
Right. So, no, I can't. That first season of The Office, or that only season of The Office, is just
unwatchable.
Yeah, it's unwatchable.
Because again, you're not.
And I love Ricky Gervais. Yeah. You know, I love like that humor and everything. But you know,
I'm not a huge fan of British comedy, but this one I liked.
Yeah. No, I definitely identify with a lot of British
mine
comedy
is
films.
Canadian comedy.
Yeah.
I go straight for Canadian comedy.
Definitely. Letterkenny.
Trailer Park Boys.
Yeah.
There's a ton. I really want to get into the ending of this movie because it's where the movie kind of like takes.
Are we gonna do the Alice character?
Oh
the
yeah,
chick?
Yeah, the chick.
Why?
Okay,
she was awesome.
She's like a high British person that pops in for two scenes and is gone.
Yeah, that was another great line where they have the secret stash. So towards the end, they're getting ready to start the jihad. They're building the bombs, and they have to do it in a safe house, which is just literally an apartment just building.
It's flat.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that was the interesting thing. When you guys said that they didn't really have much, it's like, they did. They had like different spaces.
What do you mean didn't have much? I didn't say that at all.
Somebody said that in the beginning where they like, it doesn't matter.
No. Again, this is like why. It's like, why would you be in this crazy cult of death when you have this great life in Britain and you're free and you can raise your kid however you want? You got freedom of religion. Nobody's messing with you.
It's God.
Yeah. I guess God told them to do it and they're going to do it. Well,
they just believe that, you know, the reality that they're living in is wrong.
Right.
So much so that they'll kill people for it.
Even though they're partaking in all the evil supposed things.
You got to eat.
Yeah, well, the good brother, the good one who won't kill people, he's very hardcore.
Well, I mean, now that you say that, it's kind of, it's almost like not doing the work, like cutting corners. Like, I'm not going to live as righteously as I'm supposed to.
But I'll make it up by becoming a martyr.
Yeah.
I can fast track it
Rubber Dinghy Rabbits,
and I'm good.
Well, they even talk about that, right? So at the beginning, when they are in Pakistan, right, you got Omar and Maj, whatever, they're arguing about it, what they're willing to do. Or would you kill me? Right, I would kill you. And his whole monologue about, do you want to wait in the lines? Do you go there to wait in the lines at the theme park, right? Or do you want to take the fast pass, the fast track? They even allude to that really early on. And that's kind of what I think they're talking about. When, just like you're saying, that's the fast track to get to heaven, right? You don't got to actually live differently or practice what you guys believe in.
You could eat pork.
Right. As long as you become a martyr and
you can hang out with your wife and bang all you want.
Yeah.
Hang out with your wife.
You can go to Rubber Dinghy Rapids.
I'm just saying, you don't have to put her in a cupboard. Yeah. As long as you blow up some people. Yeah. You don't even have to blow up a lot.
Just enough. Just
you don't even, they don't even have to be human.
Just a sheep.
Just a sheep. And you just have to be able to justify it, I guess.
Yeah.
But
do the mental gymnastics to make sense of it.
So anyway, yeah, so they're making all these bombs. The Hassan guy is left at the safe house to guard it. Everybody else leaves. They come back, and he's like, what's the song they're dancing to? It's the nutter, high British lady.
I don't remember.
The song is so good, too.
Yeah, and they're just dancing, and they burst into the apartment.
Dancing in the moonlight.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Everybody.
And they're just, and it's just all these great cuts of like the table is just filled with bomb making material, and and there's like fuses over there and just like
bleach.
Yeah, and it's like, and of course she's oblivious, but
bolts and nuts for shrapnel.
And so Omar's like, you got to get out of here.
We're going to do gay shit.
And she's like, why? She's like, oh, I know what's going on here. You guys are, he's like, yep.
We're gay.
Yeah. She's like, you guys are.
She called them gays. She called them a couple other things I don't remember.
Packy pushers.
Yeah.
Some British term. I'm sure it's offensive.
He's like, we are gay. We're going to do gay stuff. All
right, you got to go now.
Sound like it was like both homophobic and racist at the same time.
So now they have to.
I don't want to be your friends anymore.
Yeah, you guys aren't my friends anymore, you gay packies.
So they kick her out, and then Barry goes to Hassan.
Oh yeah.
You'd fuck her, but you won't kill her. Cause he's like, you got to kill her.
Yeah. You got to kill her. Now she knows too much.
Kill her. And he's like, oh, you'd fuck her, but you won't kill her. You pussy.
Yeah.
But anyway, so now they got to get all the shit out of there. Okay. And they've already been testing like some of the stuff. And this is where we're introduced to the night vision. So we can tell that they're a little bit under surveillance at this point.
Yeah. Somebody's watching.
Yeah. Yeah. What's his name? The dad guy, he straps a bomb to a crow.
Oh yeah,
because he really doesn't want to be the suicide bomber.
Yeah, Faisal,
and he's trying to get the crow to fly into, and of course he just blows the crow. That's the first death in this movie, by the way.
Yeah. Is the crow?
Yeah,
it was a good one.
Yeah, All the effects were great.
They were really good, yeah. Especially
for 2.5 million pounds.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was even surprised when they blew up the training camp, like how good it looked.
Oh yeah.
And all the people blowing up in that looked really good.
So now they got to get all their explosives.
Yeah, they got to change safe houses.
Right. They're driving along, of course, the hijinks ensue, shenanigans, the car breaks down. Now they gotta
walk.
Now they gotta walk with all these explosives.
That are almost, like you said, nitroglycerin. So they explode with force.
Yes.
Like if you drop it, it's gonna blow up. If you knock it too much, it's gonna blow up. So they're carefully, not carefully, going from space to space. And the hilarious part, and again, I don't know how they get separated so much, but
they constantly are getting separated.
Faisal is trailing behind, and Omar is way more behind because he's talking to his friend from work, Matt.
About squat running.
Squat jogs.
Squat jogs. Squat jogs. So fucking funny.
They're squat jogging. but like they see Faisal in the distance, and for some reason he wants to jump over this fence, and he fucking beefs it and blows up.
Yeah. Explodes.
I was surprised.
Fucking done.
I was surprised when they killed him.
Oh yeah, me too. It's like, okay, this is how the movie's gonna end.
Yeah,
I think that's the first time I looked at the time.
Oh, the running time.
About an hour.
Yeah.
Or there's about a half hour left at that point.
Yeah.
And they have to pick up his literal pieces.
The pieces of him.
And the thing that they didn't do was find his head.
No. Which comes into play later.
It comes into play later. The police find it. Falls out of a tree onto a dog.
But the one guy was, Hassan, was supposed to go bury it.
Yeah.
And of course he just threw it in a tree. all the news breaks.
Well, no,
like,
he thought
man's head falls on dog walk.
Yeah. No, yeah, they thought the knee.
Asian.
Yeah, I know. Asian. Yeah.
Which technically is correct.
Yeah, for sure.
No, but it's just kind of funny. Like, it's like, it's not just man's head. If it was like a white guy, would they say a white or a black dude? It's like, no, it's black Asian man's head falls out of a tree.
But I think this, their friend dying, pushes them into gear more. They're like, we gotta really do this now.
Well, Omar like quit.
Oh yeah,
immediately,
that's right.
And they were getting ready to change and go back to the mosque plan.
Oh, I actually really liked how they did that. Where it's like, I miss my friends, and they're gonna go on and do this thing without me.
Yeah,
and I gotta be there for them. And his wife is like really encouraging.
You really gotta go back and do it.
His wife, he's like up late at night. He's on their little chat website to supposedly like, hey, this is where we can talk without the feds.
No,
it's like
the penguin chat.
Yeah, puffin. Yeah,
which is actually, I can't remember what other movie. Some other movie about terrorists. Did something very similar. I feel like that was pulled directly from another film.
They're making fun of it.
Yeah, because I forget what fucking movie it is.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
It's super funny because that puffin talk was hilarious.
Yeah.
So the wife comes out and she's like, oh, you miss your friends. And then he's like, yeah, but I can't do this. And she's like, oh.
You were so much cooler when you were going to blow people up.
And yeah, you were so much more like, happy.
Oh, yeah, so much more happy.
It's just horrible, man.
No, I know. And also what's really weird about the movie, I think that makes it darker but still funny, there's no score.
No.
There's no score. And especially in a scene like this where she's like, oh, you were so much happier when you were going to blow.
When you're following your dreams, okay?
Well, in a normal movie, in that kind of scene, to signify that it's a comedy, you would hear like a bam, 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 or like
to signify that it was serious, it would be like sad music.
No, but it's just...
they can't have stringed instruments.
It's just fucking dry. Yeah. And you're like, ha! Wait.
The British office had no score either.
But I mean, again, that's like, it's confusing, but fun. Like, funny. You're like,
It is confusing and off-putting.
Yeah, you're like, that's fucking funny, but that's fucking wrong.
Yeah.
You're like, you're giving me, I don't know how to explain it, but it's almost like you're giving me a ham sandwich, but it's actually a shit sandwich. it's trickery.
Very much so. Well, which I think is what makes it, so what are the big, what was like the big influential comedies for you growing up? Right, where like you,
Billy Madison,
identify.
No, Happy Gilmore.
Well, mine's South Park, right? That's what I grew up with, was South Park. And I mean, that's where I was able to like see what comedy really could. Cause I mean, I grew up the same thing with Adam Sandler and stuff, but South Park pushing the envelope and
sure
giving us the ability to laugh at these fucked up things that were happening and make fun of all of these, you know,
celebrities and pop whatever cultural references and just contemporary, like literally it could happen 2 weeks ago and it'd be on South Park.
And it'd be on, right. And
Paris Hilton, whatever, you know.
And there wasn't a lot of terrorism comedy out there.
No, they definitely dabbled in that.
Yeah. But like what we're presented with here, and just like you're saying, like how wrong it feels to laugh at these things, you know?
I don't necessarily think it's wrong. It's just, it's not what I've seen before.
Exactly.
It's done in a way where I had not experienced something like this in a movie without like a score. And I think that's what makes it darker. Even something like, let's say, Naked Gun or like serious spoof or
genre spoof.
Scary movie.
Yeah, a scary movie. There might be some lines in there that like without a score would seem super fucked up. Getting raped by a ghost or you know what I mean? Like without the score, it's just something strange and unique.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I agree.
Pauses. When I say something.
No, I like it. I mean, I didn't even really think about the absence of score throughout it, because that is definitely something that, you know, we're trained and accustomed to having, you know, the accompaniment of score. And
it's what tells you how to feel.
Yeah. Yeah, they're not spoon feeding us.
The emotional cue.
Yeah, exactly.
They don't need emotional.
They didn't have them in here.
They didn't need them. There's raw dogging it.
So he goes back to his group, and they have since they are now following Barry and his plan to blow up a mosque, and it switches very, very quickly to the marathon.
They're carrying.
Well, we find out that Omar runs back to the house. They're like, get out of here. And then we see that the police are setting up this massive raid. Again, you can see the money in that, you know. And so it looks like they're all about to be taken down. All the police raid the place. You think, you know, whatever. And they go in way, way, way too hard. And
it's his brother's house.
I think just
yeah. It's the wrong place.
It's Omar's brother's place.
It's the wrong one.
And it cuts to again the bumbling cops,
which was a commentary on it because how many
they're gonna think all his brother is way more
right
fanatical because he's like a real Muslim.
Well, he's not they're not the ones. They're out fucking playing soccer with umbrellas.
Yeah,
you know
what
I mean. Like they're not out making bombs and blowing up sheep.
But they look the part.
Yeah, they look the
part.
Well,
that's exactly what the commentary I think is about. Right?
When the real guys are just these bumbling idiots
who literally, like I said, aren't going to. Prayer right. aren't really participating. I think the one that actually looks the part the most, and I think they do this on purpose, is Barry.
Yeah, the white guy.
The white guy.
And he's like right up in the public eye the whole time.
Yeah.
He's on public panels.
He makes a comment about like, you know, come on, man, it's hiding in plain sight.
Well, that was actually,
get away with it.
That was one of the best quotes. I just want to, it was, he talks about hiding in plain sight. And bollocks, I'm a liability. I am the invisible jihadi. They seek him here. They seek him there. But he's not there. He's blowing up your slag sister. And Omar says, invisible? Right. Like the time you got on the local news for baking a Twin Towers cake and leaving it at the synagogue on 9/11. The fucking funniest line.
But
that is part of the plan. Hide in plain sight.
Yeah. The movie gets a little bit more serious when they actually strap the bombs to themselves.
Yeah,
and they're going to, you know, blow people up like they're ready to go.
Yeah, they're carrying out the actual plan.
And the first one to break is Hassan.
Hassan just crumbles immediately.
Like he goes to turn himself into some cops, and then Barry quite intelligently blows him up.
Oh my God, I know.
I was surprised. I was like,
fucking on.
Yeah, and they all kind of take off. And run in different directions, and the marathon is going on. And who's the second one to go?
It is Barry. Barry's the second one to go. And this is all after. So before Hassan even breaks, Omar like convinces, you know, Wash that his
brain is his heart and his heart is his brain.
This crazy trickery sort of thing to get because Wash is having second thoughts.
He thinks it's wrong, or he feels in his heart that what they're doing is wrong.
He when it comes down to it, he realizes, yeah, how fucked up this really is, and he's out. And Omar does everything he can to convince him because he's a easily manipulatable guy and convinces him that he's okay. And this is the right thing to do.
And I don't know this for sure, but I think culturally, it has, at least how they portray it in the movie, to do something like this, you have to want to do it.
Right.
It can't be forced.
No.
Because you're no longer a martyr at that point. You're a sacrifice.
Right. You can't kill yourself.
You can't kill somebody else. You can't manipulate. It has, you know, it has to be.
It has to come from them.
Yeah, it has to be in your heart. Like, you have to want to do it, it has to be for God.
Yeah.
So, manipulating.
That's probably a lot of what Chris Morris was researching about.
Yeah.
Yeah. The motivations and, like, what exactly, how weird it is. Like you think it'd be, all you got to do is, like, what if you're making a bomb to blow people up and you blow yourself up, you know, while you're making the bomb. Does that count? Your intent was there. You had it in your heart to go kill as many people as possible.
I mean, I have no idea.
I'm sure that Chris Morris knows the answer to that.
Yeah. but nonetheless, he's manipulated. And then I think that's kind of where the moral quandary comes in. Like, Barry calls him out on it.
Yeah.
Calls Omar out on it and is like, you fucked up. Like,
right.
You changed his mind. Like, he didn't want to do it. And then I think the rest of the movie is Omar trying to talk
Waj
out of doing it because he knows he really doesn't want to do it.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And then Barry goes and blows himself up because he's getting a Heimlich maneuver. And you get a brief cameo from...
Well, and again... Jim said there's no redeemable characters in this movie. The guy giving Barry the Heimlich maneuver was a redeemable character. He only wanted to do something nice.
Yeah, and he blew up two people.
He got killed. He was the first innocent person that got killed.
No, the cop didn't
seem like he died. There was shot where there was some bystander helping the cop.
Yeah.
So Hassan literally just died for no reason.
Yeah.
The sheep guy just killed a sheep and a crow and himself.
Yeah.
And yeah, the first innocent person to die.
Yeah.
Was Hassan's victim. You're right, Chris. There was one
redeemable.
Yeah. And they were white.
And then it ends with
Omar running into Mark.
Well,
what's his name?
Matt. And trying to talk. Yeah, trying to talk Waj into giving it up. And Waj seemed to be like, he was super confused and he was had some people held hostage and he was getting ready to stop.
Is this my confused face?
Yeah, this is my confused face. And then the cops break in there and shoot the wrong guy.
Because he pushes the bomb across the table.
Yeah, and shoot the wrong guy immediately. And then Waj blows up anyway.
Well,
and
also,
as soon
before
as that
this,
happens,
what about Barry?
Yeah, Barry's the one that gets a Heimlich. And
Barry's the one who gets
Heimlich. Yeah, Barry gets the Heimlich and blows up.
Right.
Yeah.
And then Waj, he confusingly blows himself up and probably all those cops.
Probably all the cops too.
And I really like that scene when him going in there where there's literally only Muslims in there.
Right.
And the line is, you know, we're all for the jihad.
It's the kebab place.
What are you doing?
And he's trying to like justify it in his brain. It's like, well, I think I still make it. Like,
this is good enough, right?
I think also that goes to the confusion of suicide bombers. I mean, what do you think the mental level of these people are? You know, that they get to like go into and a lot of these attacks are at mosques in like Iran and Iraq. They'll go into, I guess they're the enemy Muslims or what, but you know, these massive, you know, it turns out to be a 16-year-old girl. Mm-hmm. How did they get this person to strap this on? Who even knows if she knows what she's doing?
Yeah.
It's just,
I think in reality, and again, and this is probably what they may be playing on with the Omar and Wash scenario is that
I would have to guess that most of the people, I don't know, I would say a percentage, I don't want to say most, are probably manipulated into doing it.
Yeah.
And
or true believers.
Well, indoctrinated.
Indoctrinated, yeah, and or forced.
Definitely.
Right. Like, yeah. In we're reality.
Gonna, we're going to kill your wife if you don't do this.
Well, and a lot of the times, I mean, they're fucked up on drugs. A lot of ISIS was fueled by cheap amphetamines.
And now,
you know what I mean?
In
you
Africa, get a bunch- they use that. Cot, whatever it is, it's supposed to be a natural amphetamine.
Kratom,
yeah. Whatever, Kratom. Whatever it takes. Yeah. Whatever it takes.
I mean, Nazis used methamphetamines. Used yeah. It's not uncommon, but Omar is trying to talk
Waj
out of it, and so is Benedict Cumberbatch. He's also trying to talk him out of it.
He's completely useless.
Yeah. What kind of girls funny. Do you like? Yeah, yeah. Oh, you're an ass man. What do you call me, gay?
Well, and then Waz even had a good line with him, too. He's like, is this your first time? Yeah. Are you a virgin? Yeah, yeah, is this your first hostage negotiation?
And he's like, oh, I'm going to get in trouble for this. That's all these people care about. And also there's like these snipers who...
they shoot the fucking wrong bear. That was hilarious.
They shot a Wookiee.
Yeah. It's a Wookiee. That's so they're looking for a bear.
This marathon, some people are running in costume and they're like, what's the target? What's the target? It's a bear, you know, and he sees like Omar in kind of a bearish. It's a honey bear. I don't know what it
must
is.
Be a character.
It's probably like a
British
mascot.
Serial character or
British
something.
Party. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And he's running right in front of him is a guy in a Chewbacca suit. Yeah. And the one sniper is a... two-man sniper team, and they shoot the Chewbacca guy.
Bear down. Yeah. We got him. Wait, I think that was a Wookiee.
Yeah, that's a Wookiee. Like, that wasn't a bear.
It was a Wookiee.
The target was a bear, Wookie. And I shot the bear.
Yeah.
Notice how they couldn't say the word Chewbacca.
Yeah, nobody was competent. Nobody did their job right here. Yeah, and in the end, after everything said and done. They're
covering their asses.
Yeah, everything said and done. They're like, no, we were certain we shot the bomber first, and the bomb blew up on accident. And that wasn't our fault. I mean, there was like all this backpedaling and trying to, you know.
The only thing I was a little confused about is why Omar walked into the place that he walked into. It was like a makeup store or something.
No, I think that was part of the joke because there were two instances earlier about let's go in and slag is like a term for a slut.
Yeah.
Let's go blow up where they sell the condoms that make us want to fuck white chicks.
White chicks.
Was good. Oh, yeah.
And that's what it was.
Oh, was that the place?
That was the place. Oh, it was
like a callback.
It was just a scene.
There you go. Thank you, Jim. But, yeah. Thank you.
Explanation there.
And yeah, like tell everybody I was smiling.
Yeah, he tells the Matt
he's like,
guy.
Are you smiling? And he like busts out kind of a little half smile.
So, yeah, that was Four Lions. It might not seem like we were talking about a comedy.
Here's my question. Do you guys think Omar made it to the 72 Virgin Paradise?
I think it depends on...
That's a loaded question there.
I would have to say no, because I don't think he believed in the cause that he was doing. I think he killed himself because he had no other choice. Is a selfish choice.
But if he had believed, then...
Yeah. Then yes. And then I think it would depend on who was in that store.
So probably the only one who has really made it was Barry.
Yeah.
He was the only true believer in all of
it. I was like,
it.
You're the only one who really gets me. I really liked that you wanted to kill all those Muslims.
He was being strategic.
Yeah. False flag, man.
Punching himself in the face. We'll get to the thumbs up, thumbs down ratings.
Yeah,
Jim.
Go ahead. Yeah. I'll go, this is kind of a little, you know, a little bit of a thought process, but I really liked the opening, and it's definitely we're seeing. That's kind of how I'm thinking of these now. I did think the end dragged a little. And I had some questions, but definitely, I think it's worth seeing, and I give it an enthusiastic thumbs up. Especially if you like, you know, that dry type of
satire,
bar weddings and a funeral, British style comedy. If you have any international listeners out there,
well, I can check. We might. Yeah. So thumbs up, Jim.
Thumbs up.
I also give it a thumbs up. I think it's an interesting movie. I think it's well made. It's incredibly funny and dark. in a unique way and not your average comedy way, not just by subject matter, but again, not using specific score stuff to tell you how to feel. Very interesting filmmaking, in my opinion. So, I give it a thumbs up as well. I thought it was a sweet movie. It's very hard, like, and I think that's what they're going for. They want you to, like, love, like, sympathize with these characters and also hate yourself for it. So it's pretty good. It's pretty good. I would recommend it to somebody.
Pretty good from Chris. Yeah, this is a thumbs up for me too, man. I had a great time with this. Everything that was said, it's dark. It is different. It's unique. It's dry. And man, it's fucking hilarious. I had such a good time with these bumbling dummies in these wild situations. And I thought the end was very explosive. I don't think it was dragging at all.
Here's a question.
It's a big thumbs up.
What would be a moist comedy?
Superbad.
That's moist?
Moist.
Just curious. As opposed to dry comedy.
Anything from what's his tits?
Bong water.
Bong water.
Anything with juicy in the tip.
Yeah.
Anything with any liquid in the tip.
Yeah, there you go.
Porkies.
Yuck.
Moist. It's not good, but it's a moist comedy.
Yes.
It's not very funny.
That's a question for the audience. If you can name some moist comedies, message us.
Oh, I got one.
realsickpodcast@gmail.com.
I got a great moist comedy. What? It's not even American. Dylan knows this movie. Triangle of Sadness, man.
Yeah.
That is moist from the beginning to the end. There's a lot of anything with just water and shit and throw up and bodily fluids.
That's a great one. Are you going to pick that one soon?
I can watch and talk about that. Yeah, I don't think that many people know about it.
No. It was up for awards, though.
It was up for Best Picture in America. Yeah, so, that's how I saw it.
So next week is my pick.
Yes.
And I've been debating on what kind of movie to do, whether we should continue on these like more adult movies and or pick something that I don't think any of you would pick would be like a Disney movie.
I'm with it. Whatever you
or like
pick,
a man. Disney kids movie. And the movie that I'm going
to... Tron.
No. The movie that I'm going to go with is Angels in the Outfield.
Okay.
Oh.
I like this movie a lot. I think it's interesting. It's got a large cast of characters. I also like sports movies.
You know, I do too.
And I thought it'd be interesting. I was going to do Mighty Ducks 2.
Oh, I'm glad you picked.
Or Little Giants. Yeah. But I thought I'd go with the more adult of the movies that I was thinking of doing and do Angels in the Outfield.
Angels in the Outfield is streaming nowhere.
Oh, it's got to be on Disney.
Who has Disney?
But it stars Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
When he's 12.
Yeah. What is it? Danny Glover. Not Donald Glover, but Danny Glover. And it also...
Matthew McConaughey
is in it.
Tony Danza. Tony Christopher Danza. Lloyd. Adrian Brody.
Tons of people.
My
are
God,
this.
What a cast.
Yeah, no, that's why I picked it.
I don't think I've watched this since like early Disney days for me when I was a little kiddo.
And again, I think it's going to be...
Angels and made this movie. Since they bought the... And I'm Angel.
I just thought it would be fun to do something completely out of our wheelhouse of movies, but also something with like a ton of, you know, actors in it and see what happens.
Damn.
Good pick. Well,
all right.
Watch the movie and we will be back next week.
Thank you for listening. This has been Real Sick Podcast. I'm Chris.
I'm Dylan.
I'm Jim.